as you heard from our panelists, they will tell you why is it exciting, because of where the US-India relationship is from that perspective. My name is Sanjay Puri. I'm the chairman of the US-India Political Action Committee. We have been working on the US-India relationship for the past 12 years. Our work has been on many different fronts. We're very, very involved in the US-India civil nuclear agreement. We've been involved on immigration issues. We've been involved on counterterrorism issues. And at a broad level of the US-India relationship, that takes a large chunk of our time. We obviously are focused on issues that are important to the Indian American community, and the US-India relationship is something that is very near and dear to most Indian Americans because of the shared values between the two countries, the United States and India, because really, as Americans, they believe that geopolitically, India can be a good ally because of its values of democracy, capitalism, and rule of law. And from an economic standpoint, with a population of 1.2 million people, with the demographics of 70% of the people below the age of 35, it's a great market. If you go to India, probably as frequently as I do, I see American franchises I've never even heard their names of, Dunkin', Donuts, and many other donut places, pizza places which I've never even heard of here. So that tells me that American brand is doing very, very well out there. So I think there is a real opportunity. We've had just had a very momentous election that has happened in India. And that election was really about, not about social issues, it was really about economic issues. The perspective of the people that voted, more close to 550 million people voted, was they wanted a better life for themselves, they wanted a better life for their children. They wanted more transparency, they wanted better governance. And that translates into better infrastructure, better energy, energy resources. India, as Secretary Pritzker today is in India, and she had a big speech in front of CII, which is the big chamber of commerce. And she talked about the basis of the relationship, the economic relationship between two countries. And she said the basis of the relationship is going to be infrastructure and energy. And what better timing than our panel today? And she just gave that speech today. So having said that, when you talk about energy, natural gas seems like a great fit. For the past 2 years, every Indian political leader that has come to this country has talked about obtaining natural gas from the United States. Because they want to get away from their dependency from the Middle East. India has been working on the Iran-Pakistan-India gas pipeline. We don't know if that's going to happen because of the geopolitical issues that exist. India has been working on long-term contracts with Qatar, but the Japanese have beaten them to the punch. So there's a real opportunity for us. India has been coal dependent, but wants to really start focusing on natural gas. We have some fantastic panelists who can talk a lot more about this issue than I can. But I can tell you, I was in India recently till last week. The Prime Minister is going to be here end of September, and I can tell you this is one of the key items on his agenda in terms of energy cooperation between the two countries. And when I say energy cooperation, it is technology. India wants technology that allows it to look for natural gas, you can call it hydraulic fracturing, or whatever other things are related to that. To give you some perspective on this event, we have a great group of volunteers who really helped put this thing together. And I want to thank our very, very dedicated volunteers who are here. Jay, Michael Robinson, Jivan Lee, Prasad Omana, and Mr. Dayanan. They do a fantastic job, and they are hopefully will be coming back to us after they go back to college. And obviously we have a great dedicated team of people like Dr. Surwigar, and many others who really work hard on doing these things. And these things might seem small, but we've been working on these issues for a long period of time. We've been working on with Congressman Ted Poe on HR 2771, and with Congressman Gardner on HR 6. Now, the idea is, it's not about advancing just the natural gas relationship, it is really about advancing a strategic relationship. This, we believe, is good for the United States from an economic standpoint. It's good from India from getting it away from energy dependence on the Middle East, and it creates American jobs. India being coal dependent, this is hopefully environmentally much better from that perspective. Now, we also going to have three members of Congress. We have Congressman Ted Poe, we have Congressman Pete Olson, and Congressman Langford from Oklahoma, who will be coming in. And we'll have several staffers from our 20 offices will be coming in and out because of the way Congress operates. But we also have a wonderful moderator, Sandra, who's going to take over from me and going to turn this into a proper session with our great panelists. So I'll hand it over to her. She's with Kendall Gates, and thank you so much for being here.
I'd also like to thank USINPAC for putting together this excellent panel of speakers to my right. Before we proceed with the introductions and today's comments, a few administrative items. If you have a cell phone or BlackBerry with you, please make sure it's on silent. If you have questions for our panelists, we ask that you please hold your questions until the end. There are index cards on each of your chairs. If you'd like, please feel free to write your question on the index card and someone will come around and collect that from you. Finally, as Mr. Brewer mentioned, we have invited three congressmen to speak today, and I actually see Representative Langford sitting seated here, so I will turn the microphone back to Mr. Brewer to introduce Representative Langford before proceeding with the introduction for our panelists.
I'll give just a brief introduction for the congressman because I won't take away his speech. The congressman obviously joined Congress in 2010. Before that, he was managing a youth center which had about 51,000 students in there. It gave him a real good perspective on what it takes to run a family, the challenges that families face. He's obviously from Oklahoma, so he understands energy, he understands natural gas, and he understands being energy independent. And we hope that he will talk to why it is in the interest of the United States that we export natural gas to countries that are aligned with us in terms of our values, that gets them away from dependence on countries that might not be as reliable or have the same objectives as we do, whether they are in the Middle East or Latin America or elsewhere. And with India, we have a growing economic partnership, we have a growing strategic relationship, whether it's in the areas of democracy, in terms of terrorism. So without further ado, I'll ask Congressman Langford to come in.
Good afternoon. As is typical, it looks like we're just about to get going doing something productive and you had to stop for a member of Congress. So that seems to be everything pretty typical today. I'm Jay Kleinberg from Oklahoma. I'm from the middle of Oklahoma, Oklahoma City. I'm the Energy Policy Chairman on the Subcommittee for Oversight Government Reform. It's my joy to be able to just talk for just a couple of minutes to give you an update on some things that we're working on in the oversight area. Yes, I completely agree with where you're going. This is a very big deal for us to be able to export natural gas around the world. It's something that was unthinkable 15 years ago. It was dreamable 10 years ago. And now, as of 2015, we're going to actually start exporting LNG and have our first set of contracts going out from the Louisiana facility at Chenier. So here's the process as we walk this through. And I can tell you, basically, it is up to date. It is in the past month. The process we walk through with the Department of Energy is the law as it states right now. Is the valve is open for the export of natural gas. And I think a lot of people misunderstand that. The assumption is we have to do something to export natural gas. That's not true. The way the Natural Gas Act is written is it's the default position that we will export natural gas to our typical trading partners, let me just put it that way, non-FTA countries. So when we open that up in that relationship, it's not because Congress does something, it's because the administration gets out of the way in the process. The way the law is written, it says if it's the administration has to prove it is not in the best interest of the United States to export LNG. Obviously it is. They've done economic studies all the way up to 12 BCF of exports. Those studies show that it is in the economic best interest of the United States to do that. Not only in the economic best interest of the United States, it's also geopolitically in the best interest of the United States. The last 2 years I've worked with my committee to be able to work with the Department of Energy and find ways to be able to get them moving on that. We've had multiple hearings with the Department of Energy, specifically the fossil fuel area. We brought in the State Department to be able to talk about the process of exporting. In that time period, they have now transitioned where they used to do a type of permit with the Department of Energy, and then after you got that, then you would start the FERC process in construction. As of March, that is now flipped. Now you begin the FERC process of construction. Anyone who wants to do that can begin that process at the end of it. You'll actually get your Department of Energy permit. What does that matter? Well, it could save up to 3 years of time in construction is actually what that mattered. That gets us faster in theory to actually exporting LNG. It also expedites those different permits that should have waited in the old process from the Department of Energy, but now will go much, much faster if FERC goes first, because several of those entities were already in the FERC process and already midway through it. In fact, some of them are well beyond the midway point. The Chenier facility I mentioned earlier is the first one. They'll start exporting in 2015. They also have a couple of additional export trains ready to go that they're in the FERC process with, that they should be ready shortly after that, which means they could actually dramatically increase capacity just a year and a half later. So there's some very positive things happening with that. Now, what does that matter to us geopolitically? One is we have great relationships, including with India. That's a friendship that we've had for a long time as a nation, and we should maintain that friendship and have a relationship. A relationship that also shares not only a relationship with democracy, but also energy, binds us codependent for ideas, for innovation, but also connected with a trusted partner. The United States of America should be a trusted energy partner. And as nations around the world be able to find reliable sources of energy, they should be able to come to the United States and say, is there a reliable source? Step number one is actually getting the spigot turned on to do that. So that has been our process to do that. As of May the 29th of this year, the Department of Energy has now made a formal request to the Energy Information Agency to do the next level of study. That is, if we increase capacity of exports from 12 BCF to 20 BCF, what would that look like? And they've asked for an expedited process. We're working with the Department of Energy to try to speed that process along as well. That matters because that gives additional certainty to companies that want to do the export facilities themselves. If we get that study done, it increases the certainty that this is economically beneficial to the United States, and I think it increases our capacity to sell. So the behind-the-scenes work, the technocrat work, is in process to actually get this done. There are many producers around the country that are ready to be able to increase their ability to be able to complete the wells and actually send out the gas to the pipeline. The infrastructure is in place and expanding in multiple areas, including the northern area around the North Dakota area, where we desperately need natural gas infrastructure put in place. All those things, the steps are in process. So we're positioning correctly. Now it's just a matter of getting the federal government out of the way and developing the contract relationships for the long-term supply of LNG around the world. So grateful for the conversation. I want to hang around for a couple of minutes and get a chance to listen in. I see Ted Poe is in here as well, so he's definitely a partner and advocate for this. Also, I look forward to just hearing some of the dialogue that I came around for. So thank you for allowing me to be able to hear, and thanks for our continued friendship.
Absolutely. Thank you, Congressman. That was very, very helpful and informative, especially for people in the Native American community who might not have as much of the technicality on this issue. They are more interested in geopolitical relationship, but it's important for them to know. As you mentioned, we have Congressman Ted Poe also here. He's been one of the biggest champions on this issue. He's been the biggest champion on the US-India relationship issue, but also on this issue. He's from the proud Texan, from the 2nd District of Texas. He made his reputation as a prosecutor. I read somewhere that it was called poetic justice of the cases that you tried, and it's obviously a great honor to have you. His focus has been on energy independence and border security, but he's really pushed this, and we hope you will listen to him and find out what we can do. He's going to build HR 2771, which we've been also pushing around in the U.S. House of Congress. The Congressman Poe, love to have you here.
Thank you. Howdy.
Howdy.
Congressman, I forgot the language. And appreciate the chance to be here with Congressman. Hope he changes his role pretty soon in November. That's my personal opinion. I know you do too, and I think that would be great. being from Oklahoma, he gets it on the issue of energy independence. I am from Texas, Houston. He mentioned Chenier in his remarks. Chenier has a plant on the other side of the Sabine River that's between us and Sabine River is an international border between Texas and Louisiana. Chenier's headquarters is in Houston, Texas. Being from Texas, energy is very important to us economically, and it's also important politically. I serve on the Foreign Affairs Committee, and I'm chairman of the Subcommittee on Terrorism, Nonproliferation, and Trade. Those are three odd couples, so to speak, TNT Committee, Terrorism, Nonproliferation, and Trade. But specifically, first of all, I hope that the efforts by Mr. Brad Sherman, California, myself, and then other members of Congress are successful, and that we're able to have Prime Minister Modi speak before a joint session of Congress very soon. We made that request to the White House. We hope that's successful, and that the Prime Minister will be able to talk to all members of the U.S. House, which goes to say the relationship between the United States and India, I think, is good and should be strengthened and move forward on all levels. Because, as Congressman Langford said, it is a democracy, it's the biggest democracy in the world, but also economically as well. 6 years ago, no one would have ever thought that we would have so much natural gas in the United States that we would be able to export it. That means send it somewhere else. And now we are in that situation. We have a lot of natural gas. There is so much natural gas in the United States that wells in West Texas are being capped. Wells in South Texas and the Dakotas are flaring off natural gas. I'll give you a statistic, but this one's easier to understand. It's 1,500 wells. What does that mean? That is enough energy to supply 1 million homes that is being flared off every day because we don't have the market. We have the markets, but we're not being able to export that natural gas. I abide by the philosophy of an ice cream company, and the greatest ice cream company in the world, the greatest ice cream, is in Brenham, Texas.
Bluebell
ice cream. Who said that? Oh, I get it. It's Bluebell ice cream. You need to know this. It's a historical horse. And their motto is, we eat all we can and we sell the rest. Well, that should be our philosophy about natural gas. Use all we can, sell the rest. And where should we sell it? Well, we should sell it to India. When I was in India a couple of years ago, I talked to a lot of government officials. The only thing they wanted to talk about was not Pakistan. It was Texas, U.S. natural gas. Sell us natural gas. And they kept telling me this. Congressman, you know, one of my attention, Congressman, there are 1 million more people and are a billion more people in India than there are in the United States. 1,300,000,000. They kept saying that. We can use the natural gas. Sell it to us. And Congressman Langford's going through all of the mechanics of it. My opinion is, you know, it's been taking too long. It takes too long to get this process approved with FERC, the Department of Energy, and get that gas flowing to India and other countries. Why is the Department of Energy involved in this? It's a law passed in the 30s. I think it was passed because during the Depression, with war on the horizon, government officials want to make sure that natural gas that was produced in the United States was sold in the United States and consumed in the United States. That was never a problem. We didn't export it. Just a few years ago, we had the ability. Now, because we have the ability to export it, the Department of Energy weighs in and has to give its approval as well. Now, the process takes, in my opinion, too long to do it. We will hopefully, with Congressman Langford and others pushing that, will and legislation that the House passed, that will be speed up quite a bit, and we'll be able to get that natural gas to other parts of the world. But it's not just India. You've all heard about the situation with the Russians in Ukraine. Being on the Foreign Affairs Committee, we hope to be able to export natural gas to Europe to give them competition, or give them an alternative to Gazprom from Russia, give them an economic competition alternative. Right now, they're held hostage by our Russians and Gazprom. So it's not just one country, selling natural gas worldwide on the world market will help stabilize the world and also get energy to parts of the world that need it, and it's also economically beneficial to all of us concerned. The currently, there is one company, just one, that has the ability to export natural gas to India. There's still a lot of those 1 billion, 300 billion folks in India that will need natural gas. So we want to be able, we want more companies to be able to export it. I believe there are about 33 projects that have applied for permission to export natural gas, and Department of Energy has approved 7 of them. So 33, 7 have been approved. What does that mean, but besides the delay economically on this end? Well, there's competitors worldwide with the sale of natural gas from the United States. And we want to be able to have a better relationship with India economically because it helps both countries politically. Natural gas energy consumption in India is growing at a phenomenal rate. And it's going to continue to grow. It's not going to be less need, less demand. There's going to be more demand. And what would be the alternative for India for energy if the United States doesn't supply them or some other country export natural gas? Well, then the Indians may have to find themselves participating in the Iran-Pakistan gas pipeline. Now, if you were picking of all of the 194 countries in the world, the worst two that you may pick would be Iran and Pakistan, maybe not in that order. And yet, to have natural gas coming from those countries, I wouldn't want that to be the alternative for anybody, especially India. But that would be the competition, that would be the place where India may have to get its energy if it's not being able to get it somewhere else, and then eventually down the road, develop its own infrastructure to produce energy in India. So that is the political reason, one political reason. Don't want that to be an alternative for the folks in India. With the Middle East in turmoil, as it has been for a long time, we never know about Middle Eastern energy, and therefore we can make that politics really, U.S. can make it irrelevant if we are energy independent, not just natural gas, but with crude oil, including Texas sweet crude, which we have so much of that, we could export that as well, which is another issue that we could talk about at some later time. So I was glad to see H.R. 6 pass the House of Representatives. It's a good piece of legislation. I hope that we move forward with expediting the sale of natural gas. We can sell it, we can produce it, sell it to India, make a profit, and India can still get it cheaper than they can get it somewhere else. That's the economic advantage for both nations. And I appreciate the chance to talk to you. And that's just the way it is.
Nice way to say lobbyist.
very literally way to say lobbyist, I think. Mr. Desai will provide us some very company-specific perspectives on the LNG industry right now. Seated next to him is Mr. Eric Alito. Mr. Alito is Director of Upstream Industry Operations for the American Petroleum Institute, which has over 600 members involved in all aspects of the oil and gas industry in the United States. Mr. Alito's work covers regulatory and legislative matters related to domestic exploration and production, including access to domestic oil and natural gas resources, both onshore and offshore. Prior to his current position, Mr. Alito served as API managing counsel, covering a host of legal issues, including oil, natural gas leasing, royalties, environment, fuels, transportation, safety, and civil justice reform. Mr. Alito will speak to us today about the benefits of the United States of exporting natural gas to India, and will also provide us with a more general industry perspective on LNG exports. Next, we'll hear from Dr. Michael Gaines, who is a distinguished fellow at the Logistics Management Institute, or LMI, in McLean, Virginia, where he conducts research on energy and environmental matters. While at LMI, Dr. Gaines has directed the LMI Research Institute and was a contributing author to the 2008 Defense Science Board study of Defense Department's energy strategy titled More Fight, Less Fuel. Prior to coming to LMI, Dr. Gaines was the Vice President and Chief Economist of the American Petroleum Institute, where he served for 25 years. At API, Dr. Gaines was responsible for the Institute's economic research and statistical publications and was frequently interviewed and quoted in trade and public media. Dr. Gaines holds a PhD in economics from UCLA and an MSc in economics from the London School of Economics, as well as an MBA and a BS in mathematics from the University of Chicago. Dr. Gaines will speak to us about the economic, strategic, and environmental benefits of exporting natural gas to India. Our penultimate speaker will be Dr. David Montgomery, who is an expert on economic issues associated with petroleum and natural gas markets and climate change policy. Dr. Montgomery has written and testified on energy and environmental issues for more than 40 years. His scholarly work is frequently published in peer-reviewed journals, and on numerous occasions, Dr. Montgomery has testified before congressional committees on climate change, oil and gas markets, and other energy market and environmental issues. As is particularly relevant to our discussion today, Dr. Montgomery led a study of the economic impact of LNG exports that was released by the Department of Energy in December 2012, and an update to which was released in May 2014. His current work includes oil and gas export issues, as well as regulatory policies affecting the oil and gas industry, including renewable fuel standards. Prior to entering consulting, Dr. Montgomery held a number of senior positions in the United States government. For example, he was assistant director of the U.S. Congressional Budget Office and a deputy assistant for policy in the U.S. Department of Energy. He also headed energy modeling and forecasting activities at the Energy Information Administration. Dr. Montgomery holds a PhD in economics from Harvard University and was a Fulbright Scholar at Cambridge University. Dr. Montgomery will expand upon the economic discussion today and provide us with some insight from your studies. Finally, Mr. Sadanand Dumi will speak to us. He is a resident fellow at the American Enterprise Institute, where he writes on South Asian political, economic, foreign policy, business, and society, with a focus on India and Pakistan. Mr. Dumi has served as India Bureau Chief to the Far East Energy Economic Review and as an Indonesia correspondent of FEER. In addition, Mr. Dumi is currently a South Asia columnist for the Wall Street Journal. Previously, Mr. Dumi was a Bernard Schwartz Scholar at the Asia Institute in Washington, D.C. Mr. Dumi will provide us with some conclusory comments as well as the U.S.-India trade relations and their strategic importance to us today. Finally, we will hear remarks from Ms. Sue Ghosh of USINPAC, who will just give us some closing remarks before we get to our question and answer session. Unfortunately for you all, I am the next speaker, so I will just continue speaking. As the congressman both touched upon, the United States is in the middle of an energy boom. 30 or 40 years ago, we would not have been able to have this discussion about exporting natural gas to any of our strategic allies, let alone to India. The reason that we're able to have this conversation today is advances in technology have allowed us to identify and access our abundant domestic natural gas reserves. If you read the newspaper on a regular basis, you very likely have seen references to the shale revolution, shale gale. I'm very familiar with the shale bonanza. There are statistics that we have 155 years worth of natural gas based on current consumption rates, and that we will outpace our production will outpace our consumption in 2019. So what this means is that the United States has an abundance of supply, and the question is whether we will take advantage of this opportunity to continue our economic revitalization and create thousands of jobs in the energy sector throughout this country, while also strengthening our relationships with strategic allies like India. When we talk about natural gas exports, we often talk about it in terms of LNG or liquefied natural gas. For anyone in the room who's not familiar with this term, LNG is the exact same molecule of natural gas that flows into your home to use in your stove or in your home heating system. It's just cooled to negative 260 degrees Fahrenheit, but it becomes liquid. In its liquid state, natural gas takes up 1/600 of the amount of space that it takes up in a gaseous state. So you can imagine that if you're trying to export large volumes of natural gas, it's much more cost effective to export that gas as LNG instead of natural gas. Now, the exports of natural gas are regulated by two federal agencies in the United States, the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, or FERC, and the Department of Energy. As the Congressman mentioned, FERC has authorization over the siting, construction, and operation of the LNG export facilities. The FERC process is a very robust review of these proposed facilities, and it focuses mainly on environmental and safety concerns. Part of the process includes a mandatory pre-filing process, which is a minimum of 6 months, although a number of projects have stayed in the pre-filing process for much, much longer than that. During the pre-filing process, applicants have the opportunity to have off-the-record conversations with FERC staff. And the purpose of these ex parte communications is to allow FERC staff and the project developer to work together to identify any potential issues the project may face and hopefully come up with solutions before everything is public. There is no deadline for FERC to issue an order on an application for these export facilities. However, looking at the import context, it's generally about 18 to 30 months. Some projects have moved through much faster, and some obviously have taken much longer. I mentioned that the FERC review is primarily an environmental and safety review. Throughout the course of this review, FERC will coordinate with other federal, state, and local agencies, including the Department of Transportation, Pipeline and Hazardous Materials Safety Administration, which regulates the safety of LNG terminals, the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, which regulates the Clean Air and Clean Water Act, as well as the U.S. Coast Guard, which is responsible for any vessel traffic that is necessary to enable the LNG vessels to transit in our waterways. FERC serves as the lead agency in preparing the final environmental review document for these facilities, and other agencies like the Department of Energy participate as cooperating agencies. The other authorization that is required is the authorization from the Department of Energy, which is much more public and has been in the media much more. This authorization is to export the commodity itself. It's the license to export the molecules. The process for long-term authorizations, which are authorizations to export for 2 years or more, depends solely on the destination to which the exports are going. As the Congressman mentioned, exports to our free trade agreement nation partners, which are partners with which the United States has a free trade agreement requiring national treatment of natural gas. Those have to be granted under the Natural Gas Act without modification or delay. The office within the Department of Energy that processes these applications is the Office of Fossil Energy, and that office, as far as I know, is staffed by 4 or 6 people, which is not a very large number, especially considering the number of demands that they have on them of all of the other applications pending and their potential procedural changes. So at this point in time, without modification or delay, it means about 5 months to get an FTA authorization. For other countries, for non-FTA countries, which include India, these are countries that the United States does not have a free trade agreement with, but with which trade is not prohibited for any other reason. Under the Natural Gas Act, the Department of Energy will engage in a public interest analysis and must grant the application unless it finds that the proposed export is inconsistent with the public interest. Very important point. It's a small point, but it's a very important point that there is a rebuttable presumption that these exports are in the public interest. And it is the job of anyone who opposes the export to demonstrate that it is not. To date, there has not been sufficient information introduced into any of the records to enable DOE to deny one of these applications. I mentioned this is the part of the process that has been heavily discussed in media and on Capitol Hill. The majority of the debate for non-FTA nations has centered around the public interest analysis and the process itself. DOE does not have any specific criteria that it has to evaluate when it determines whether or not a project is in the public interest. As of today, still to date, DOE uses a flexible, market-driven approach. And many who have opposed LNG exports or who have tried to stall the process have sought to impose prescriptive, criteria-based indicators into public interest analysis. In addition, there's been a lot of discussion around the timing, which is what the efforts at Capitol Hill have been aimed at, making it a faster process. It's helpful to give you a little bit of background so you can understand some of the comments that our other panelists will make today. The Congressman mentioned that in 2011, the Department of Energy issued a final order for Cheniere's being passed trains 1 through 4. As of today, that's the only terminal in the United States that has both final FERC authorization and final DOE authorization to export to non-FTA countries. When it issued that order, it also announced that it would pause. And DOE paused for 2 years to conduct an economic analysis of the impacts of natural gas exports on the U.S. economy. This two-part study, which is called the LNG Export Study, included a microeconomic study by the Energy Information Administration, and it looked at the impacts of exports up to 12 BCF a day. And it also included a macroeconomic study, which was conducted, as I mentioned in the introduction, by Dr. Montgomery's your consulting group. Dr. Montgomery's study, which I think he will talk a little bit more about today, examined exports up to unlimited export scenarios and found that in all scenarios, there were net economic benefits to the United States. As I mentioned, it was 2 years until DOE, it was 2 years from the date that DOE issued the being passed order until it issued the LNG export study results. And at that time, in December 2012, DOE also issued a queue, and the queue set the sequence in which it would consider the then pending applications. And I should note that sequence was not based on first come, first serve. It also injected some of the FERC process and where those applications stood in the FERC process into the queue. And then DOE also included that it would process any future applications on a first come, first serve basis. To date, DOE has stuck to this queue. And in public statements, DOE officials have explained up until May 29th of this year that they would continue to proceed with the queue in the order that it existed in 2012. Another practice that is important to note that DOE has engaged in is issuing two orders for each application. It issues a conditional authorization and a final authorization. The conditional authorization is conditioned on successful completion of the FERC process and DOE's issuance of satisfactory environmental review documents. As I noted, DOE acts as a cooperating agency with FERC in FERC's preparation of the environmental review document for the terminal. What we have seen to date that DOE will do is it will actually take the FERC final environmental review document, perform its own internal review of the document, state that it agrees with the conclusions of the document, and reissue it as its own, which is appears to be permitted to do under law. As the Congressman mentioned, on May 29th of this year, DOE announced proposed procedural changes to the way that it has processed non-FTA applications. The important points of these proposed changes are that it is proposing to no longer issue conditional authorizations. It will only issue final authorizations. It is proposing to completely eliminate the queue and only base the timing by which it issues final authorizations on the FERC process. And importantly, on FERC's issuance of a final environmental review document. Comments on these proposed changes were due on July 21st, and we have yet to see what the final proposal will look like from DOE. In the meantime, DOE has said that it will continue to process the pending applications as it would have before, which means we should expect to see a conditional authorization for the Oregon LNG terminal shortly. It certainly has been longer than DOE has taken between previous applications before. And there is the potential that we'll see a final authorization for the Cameron LNG terminal within the next couple of months. I should also mention that, like FERC, DOE does not have a deadline to issue its authorizations, neither statutorily required nor is it required under the regulations. To this end, there have been a number of efforts on Capitol Hill, which the Congressman spoke about, to change this and impose a specific deadline on DOE to act. With that, I will pass the microphone off to Mr. Desai to give us a specific industry perspective. Thank you.
Thank you, Sandra, for the introduction, and thanks for the staff who are here. Your commitment to learning this issue is why I think we've moved or progressed so far along. Especially thanks to Sandra Corey. I've known Sandra for 8 years, and he's a trusted friend and advisor, and there's not a better resource in Washington on US-Indian relations, so I encourage you to keep using Sandra and keep bothering him. What I thought I would do is talk a little bit about Cheniere, our contracts, the opportunity, and then maybe touch on the process. There's excellent speakers. We can maybe talk about that a little deeper because we have a biased perspective. Cheniere was started 13 years ago as an E&P company with pretty good success, and then went on to be the first company to build an import terminal. On the day that of the ribbon cutting, we realized that the future of imports was going to be uncertain. So it turned out to be a mistake, and because America was on the verge of the shale gas revolution. So proof that being first or having first mover advantages, not always an advantage. So then we talked about exporting. Folks thought we were crazy, and then when we did the analysis, we figured out it costs 10 times more, it's 10 times more capital intensive to export rather than import. But our CEO had a vision, and we took on the challenge, and then we soon realized that the permitting and the politics around exporting were larger than we thought they were. We applied, as Sandra mentioned, for our non-FTA application, and I guess we've talked a lot about that. FTA, non-FTA, it's important to know that we don't need special permits to export coal. We do it, and we do it pretty well, and there's no Natural Gas Act or Natural Coal Act to stop it. So this is one of the most scrutinized commodities, and sometimes we wonder why it is. We applied for this permit in 2010. By 2011, we received our pre-approval at the time, and then our final approval in April of 2012. So we had the FONSI, what they called at the time, to start construction. Today, at Sabine Pass, which Congressman Poe mentioned, is 2 hours west of Houston. We have we're planning 6 trains, which each train, all it is a pipeline that's expanded, and some engineer way back when called it a train. Is each train is half a BCF. That project at Sabine Pass on the Sabine River is a $20 billion project. 2013, we invested $5 billion into the site. 2,000 workers are at the site today. There'll be 4,500 workers at the peak. The project will generate 50,000 indirect jobs across the country. Our contracts are, it's more of the pipeline model. They're 20-year take-or-pay contracts. Our first 4 trains in the past are sold out to folks like EG, Gas Natural, Fonseca, Cogas, Total, Centrica, and Gale of India. And that's train 4, and Gale will receive its gas end of 2015 or beginning of 2016. Our next project is at Corpus Christi. It's an $11 billion project, 3 trains, over 1,000 acres, and we think we'll have our final EIS October 2014, so a couple months away, and we'll start building probably the middle of 2015. And we've signed commercial agreements with three Spanish utilities, a company in Australia, which is ironic because they have a lot of natural gas reserves themselves, EDF out of France, and we have some more gas at that terminal to sell. We think this is a huge opportunity for the United States, not just because it's free trade and we need to, you know, the Blue Bell analogy, but we think it's a great opportunity because it's going to create as many as 500,000 jobs by the time companies start exporting. It's going to expand our economy, increase GDP up to $86 billion. The DOE NIR study, which Dr. Montgomery conducted, it shows that exports will increase, and as exports increase, so does economic growth. It's going to reduce the deficit up to $16 billion, improve the balance of trade, reduce price volatility and stabilize domestic markets by drilling activity in dry gas plays such as the Haynesville and Barnett, which Congressman Poe mentioned, are limited due to low gas prices, and the national security significance that so many in the room are concerned about, reducing our dependence on foreign resources of energy, and which will improve our national security. And a lot of it has been made about American manufacturing. Well, we in the industry are manufacturers. We make LNG, and we represent just our first four trains, $2.3 billion in investment in American manufacturing across 22 states. Predominantly, a lot of that is in Oklahoma and Texas and Louisiana, and also $500 million in foreign investment. So this is just on four trains, the project, and what we're doing to American manufacturing with our subs that we hired from Bechtel. We also believe expanding exports would have great geopolitical implications and benefits. U.S. LNG exports will develop competition in the market, drive towards market-based pricing, regardless of where LNG is shipped. Competition will bring down prices for consumers everywhere, including our allies in Europe and Asia. And it will send a signal to the Russians. We have an opportunity to send a clear signal that U.S. LNG exports will be supported by the government and will offer European countries an alternative to current Russian supply. The result of 6 BCF U.S. LNG export being shipped worldwide, not just to Europe, would reduce Russia's revenues from natural gas, either from lost sales or reduced prices to new customers, by up to $4 billion a year, according to Deloitte. And it's the environmental impact. It's going to lower global emissions by replacing coal by cleaning and burning natural gas. And here's an interesting statistic. We're on track to meet our Kyoto Agreement standards despite never ratifying the agreement, which is ironic. It's also going to help with market-based pricing. LNG exports from the U.S. will increase global competition and provide buyers an alternative to expensive LNG supplies linked to oil. That's also something that is, you should take into account that how oil is linked. It's going to help the global market. The conflict in the Ukraine has brought a sense of urgency to find sources of energy demands. And Senator touched on this a bit, but the DOE approval changes, which here as a company is supportive of, because we think commercial viability has been taken into account for the first time after you finish your FERC process, which we measured costs about $125 million. You are done with that process, then you ask DOE for the permit. And we think it's, we rather than have approved them all, but we think it's the best realistic opportunity, especially in an election year. The DOE permit process, just, you know, the DOE permit cost us anywhere from, you know, $50,000, including legal fees, and the FERC permit was $100 million. So a lot harder to do, so we believe the DOE decision was sensible. So in closing, we're excited to work with USINPAC on educating Congress and working with companies like Gale to ensure energy and economic security across the globe. And thank you, and thank you for your time. And if there's questions later, I think we'll be able to answer. Thanks.
Thank you very much. I'd also like to send my thanks to USINPAC and Mr. Sir. Great to be on this panel for us. I feel like I don't have much to say. I mean, we had Congressman Langford and Congressman Poe kind of lay out, you know, why we need to do this, why we need to move forward in the long path that we need to go with when it comes to free trade. We just heard about all the benefits when it comes to moving forward with LNG exports, job creation, clean energy, the importance of trade. We're going to hear more from the architect of the study that put together the economic analysis for DOE, which shows that the more you export, the greater the benefits. This seems like such a slam dunk issue. It seems like every angle that you look at shows that we should be doing this and we should be moving forward quickly because, as we heard more than once, the law is in the favor of exports. The presumption is that you should export unless you can overcome that and show that it's not in public interest. That has not been demonstrated, and it's not going to be demonstrated. I'm sure Dr. Montgomery's going to hit that a little more because the only thing I'm looking at is, okay, what if we actually do export more than 12 BCF per day? And right now, we've already seen a lot of analysis which shows, well, the impacts just aren't going to be there on the price. So when you're looking at the different issues that we're trying to tackle here, the one that we keep coming back to here in the U.S. is the price issue. And the more we get into studying this over time, the more we realize our supplies of natural gas are actually much higher than we expected. And the price projections going way out in the future are lower than we expected. So we keep hearing about a price of natural gas being around $5 to $6 per MCF, which our manufacturers continue to tell us is well within their range of comfort when it comes to bringing manufacturing here to the United States. So we're in this odd debate. Then going back less than 10 years ago, looking at it from another angle, which I think is one of the most powerful angles that we try to make sure that we're echoing in the halls of government. If you look back 10 years ago, less than 10 years ago, we were expected to import $10 billion worth of gas into the United States from West Africa, Middle East, Russia, and Australia. Well, that's just not happening. What does that mean? That means those gas supplies are now in the global market. And that has done a tremendous amount of good for the global demand and consumption for natural gas. And you have countries that have been able to negotiate better deals with Russia just because of that. So you take the additional gas that we've already put on the market because of the shale revolution. Now we have an opportunity to add to that through the work of great companies like Cheniere and others who want to build these multi-billion dollar investments to take it to countries like India, creating greater diversification supplies coming from a stable North American energy system. So we're looking at a whole lot of promise here, and there's a lot of optimism about the path forward with DOE. And with the administration, I'm actually withholding opinion until we see how the process moves forward because there's still a lot of unknowns as to how it's going to play out. But ultimately, it's going to be through the voice of the Prime Minister of India, through delegations from India, just like we've seen with the countries from Central and Eastern Europe who have been knocking on the door of the State Department, Department of Energy, the White House, letting them know that we want this gas. And the other part of it is we keep talking about carbon dioxide emissions, greenhouse gas emissions. It's pretty clear that there is a strong environmental benefit from natural gas use when it comes to electricity generation. It's about half when you use natural gas compared to other sources. And we know that from the U.S. standpoint, we're going to need coal, oil, natural gas for decades to come. All of the above includes all those. But there is a strong argument for natural gas when it comes to greenhouse gas policy debate. We can't lose that perspective because there's all these questions. Well, we're not sure about this natural gas and whether it's dirty or not. It's not dirty. Putting aside greenhouse gas emissions, look at the other types of pollutants that you know, talk about, sulfur oxides, nitrogen oxides, particulate matter, mercury. The emissions of those pollutants are significantly lower than other potential forms of energy for electricity generation, if not at level zero. So you have national security, you have environmental issues, where we're talking about a clean burning source of energy, and we have the free trade and partnership that we want to ensure that we're moving forward with. And then here in the U.S., we have that jobs potential, where it could be, if it's just a little LNG exports and tens of thousands of jobs, and if we move to a situation where it's 12 BCF or even 16 BCF a day, it's hundreds of thousands of jobs. And as we heard from our friends at Chenier, they talked about how it impacts jobs in several states, but I can tell you right now that LNG exports results in additional production of natural gas. And this production in the shale revolution has resulted in jobs and business for companies, small businesses, medium businesses, large businesses, in every state in the country and the District of Columbia. So you have small businesses, one man, two man shops, you've got medium-sized companies, large-sized companies in every state and the district who are benefiting from the production of natural gas here in the United States. How do I know that? We're just finishing up a survey. We've just got a few weeks that shows a list of companies, and we have enough companies in Hawaii who are getting business from the natural gas revolution. Environmental consulting firms, a lot of companies that contribute to this. So we have a great story here in the U.S., and we're hopeful that that story is going to continue to extend to our partners in India by having this natural gas shared with an important ally in that part of the world. So I'm going to stop there, turn it over to Mr. Dr. Gaines and Dr. Montgomery and others, and keep this roll.
Thank you, and good afternoon, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here, and in a moment, I'll give you my views on the exports of LNG from the U.S. to India. But first, I have to say that the opinions I'm stating today are mine, my own, and don't reflect those of the Logistics and Energy Institute or the report, nor the U.S. Association for Energy Economics, of which I am the current president. Neither LLM or USAEE takes a position on matters of public policy. So why do I raise that about USAEE? Well, it's a professional association with about 1,000 economists, and I suspect you already recognize that if you ask 1,000 economists their opinions on some given matter, whether it's LNG exports or anything else, you'll get approximately 1,000 different perspectives. And as a consequence, when you're the president of the organization, you have to say, hey, I'm not speaking from all these characters in there, I'm just speaking from here. So that's why. My general viewpoint on this issue. I'm wholeheartedly supportive of the export of LNG from the U.S. to India. In my view, there will be economic, strategic, and environmental benefits from such exports. And the sooner they can occur, the greater these benefits will be. I'll address each of these assessments in turn. Economic benefits. Economic benefits should ensue to both the U.S. and India in the form of gains from trade. The U.S. obtains resources in exchange for gas that it can produce and export relatively cheaply, and it can use those resources to obtain a wide variety of products on international markets. From a U.S. consumer perspective, the price of natural gas will rise somewhat, while the cost of imported goods will be lower via the strengthened value of the U.S. dollar. On balance, U.S. consumers will gain. In India, consumer benefits will take a different form. The price of gas will be lower, while the price of other imported goods will be slightly higher. But on balance, India consumers also will benefit. There will be benefits to producers. Natural gas producers and pipelines will gain in the U.S., while gas-using producers of goods and services will gain in India. Not all firms in either country will benefit, but the gains will outstrip the losses. GDP and employment will be helped in both countries. Two recent studies verify these points. Since David is on the panel and he's one of the co-authors, there's no need for me to get into the findings of that study. Suffice it to say that the study shows U.S. gains measured by GDP, employment, and consumer welfare. The study focuses on overall LNG exports from the U.S., not just on goes to India. But since India potentially is going to be part of the export market, some of the benefits will be attributable to this particular opportunity. A second study performed by the Deloitte Center for Energy Solutions takes a somewhat different perspective. It shows that the impact of LNG exports on U.S. natural gas prices is likely to be modest, only about 12 to 20 cents per 1,000 cubic feet, while gas production will be significantly enhanced. The range there is about a little over 2 trillion cubic feet per year. The Deloitte study indicates that there will be considerable economic gain with few of any accompanying downsides. What it really shows is that there's kind of a flat supply curve over a relatively long region, so that gas prices will go up some, but we'll get a lot more production at relatively modest increases in price. And so there can, and it concludes, therefore, that there are a few downsides to the export of this gas. And again, though India is only one part of the potential gas export market, the conclusions of that study pertain. It goes without saying that U.S. economic growth has been less than hoped for over the last few years. Investment in and construction of LNG export facilities can be a help in correcting that situation. Strategic benefits. The calculation of strategic gains is more difficult because country relationships are very and very complicated. I believe that the relationship between the U.S. and India will be unambiguously strengthened through further trade between the two nations, of which LNG can be an important component. In my view, we should seize every opportunity to enlarge trade between the two countries as a friendly means of making consumers in both countries better off. There also will be strategic consequences pertaining to other gas exporters and consumers. Generally speaking, I believe these consequences will be positive for the U.S. and for India, but they are not straightforward. Some allies of both countries likely will be helped, but others might be adversely affected. So, for example, Norway, Canada, the Netherlands, they're all gas exporters. So the price of gas is going to be lower with U.S. gas exports, so they will not be helped by that, and they are allies of the United States. But similarly, some who are not friendly to the U.S. or India might be helped or hurt. It seems evident that at least one country, Russia, has chosen to use gas exports as a strategic asset, which, if nothing else, should enter into U.S. thinking and strategy. However, the overall strategic consequences for the U.S. and India of LNG gas trade is more complicated than a single example and requires detailed country-by-country analysis, which I have not done. Nevertheless, in my view, the direct gains to the U.S. and India alone of enhanced trade are sufficient to guarantee a net strategic benefit to these two countries. Environmental benefits. The expansion of natural gas production has raised at least two environmental concerns within the United States. One has to do with hydraulic fracturing, which is a means of loosening rock beneath the surface to allow increased extraction. The use of chemicals in hydraulic fracturing and the disposal of wastewaters are central aspects of this concern. The other is the impact of increased natural gas production on global climate change, partly from the burning of gas and partly through its leakage during production, transport, and distribution. Neither of these concerns is of much importance in India. The LNG will be imported. It is generally going to be burned in lieu of coal, which is a more potent greenhouse gas. I'll return to that in just a moment. A good deal of study is focused on hydraulic fracturing in the United States. My take is that careful regulation can negate most of the adverse impacts and is generally in place. Individual states have most of this responsibility and have been regulating hydraulic fracturing for decades. No doubt, it is always possible to improve such regulation, but the record over many years is supportive that this technique can be implemented with adequate protection for the environment. Climate change is a different kind of challenge. Thinking on this issue in the United States has been remarkably inwardly directed. By that I mean that advocates on both sides of the issue have focused almost entirely on U.S. action or non-action. But because the issue is worldwide, so too must be solutions. In India, for example, coal consumption is about three-quarters that of the United States, but it's growing rapidly, while that in the U.S. is diminishing. Over the 5 years, 2008 through 2013, U.S. coal consumption fell by almost 20%, while that of India rose by over 40%. isn't going to take long at such rates for any adult assumption to a CPAP of the United States. So what does that imply for U.S. LNG exports to India? That the sooner we can help India substitute natural gas for at least some adult consumption, the better off we'll be in GHG terms. This seems straightforward, but it requires American environmental interests to think beyond our shores and to understand that what we do has to be viewed in an international context. Summing up, I see economic, strategic, and environmental benefits from the export of LNG from the U.S. to India. Hopefully, our government, as well as India's, will rapidly facilitate a move in that direction. And that concludes my remarks. Thank you very much.
Join this panel. It's been a pleasure listening to other speakers, and since they have done such a good job of summarizing the results of our first study for the Department of Energy, I think I will try. I will try to do two things. The first is mention some of the conclusions that we reached in the update to that study, which we released in May of 2014. That was particularly intended to focus on the question of what the economic benefits to the U.S. will be if we export more than 12 BCF of, per day of LNG, hoping that it would help the Department of Energy to worry less about whether it had a firm economic rationale for going beyond 12 BCF in its conditional authorizations of LNG exports. We also wanted to look at some criticisms of our earlier study that we did not pay careful enough attention to what might be happening to U.S. manufacturing industry, and then the usual complaint in Washington that if you didn't use today's data, you should do everything all over again in order to slow things down. So we wanted to deal with those three issues in our study. As far as going beyond the 12 BCF mark, we developed some scenarios based on the Energy Information Administration's range of projections of U.S. natural gas production that were in EIA's 2014 annual energy outlook. And when we used those projections, we actually found that the potential was there for the U.S. to export more natural gas with less impacts on U.S. prices and with larger economic benefits. So we were moving in exactly the direction that Mike Haynes mentioned, that every time we look, we are seeing that the natural gas resource is looking better, the technology for producing gas is getting cheaper and cheaper, and we're looking at more optimistic projections of natural gas. Now, in our analysis, we didn't just look at different decisions by DOE of where to cut off natural gas exports. We looked at what would happen with a totally free market in natural gas. That is to just take the Department of Energy out of the picture and let the market determine where exports would go and what the prices would end up being. And what we found in that case was, contrary to some fears, the United States will not be exporting more gas than we are consuming. The market has a natural limit, we will be moving to higher and higher cost production in the U.S. We have competitors in the world who, some of them actually probably have lower costs than the United States does of producing, and so there's a limit that the market will place. The limit is going to depend on how cheap it is to produce gas in the United States, so those were our scenarios for natural gas, for the natural gas resource. And it's going to depend on what supply and demand is in the rest of the world. So we made different assumptions about how high demand could go in the rest of the world, basically by looking at different kinds of shutdowns of nuclear power, which gives us maybe not necessarily a realistic assessment, but gives us something which is a, there are increments to natural gas demand that we can point to and see that they are in the bounds of possibility. So we looked at higher and higher levels of gas demand, which of course would lead to higher exports. And we looked at lower levels of supply from other countries that they simply didn't carry through on the plans that we were assuming in our reference case for production. And we found in all of those cases that U.S. that exports, exactly what Mike said, the more we had an opportunity to export from the U.S., the greater the economic benefits were to the U.S. The more we couldn't eat and had to sell, the greater the economic benefits were to the U.S. And this was true all the way up to, you know, perhaps 30 BCF, which was the highest that we saw the market ever being willing to take. Now, of course, one of the problems with DOE or anybody else putting a limit on natural gas exports is what makes sense as what would be harmless as a limit in one case could be terrible in another case. So the notion of, well, you know, how much are we going to export is a question that has many answers. This depends on all of these cases, the market. And in fact, we had many scenarios in which the market didn't take any natural gas from the U.S. at all. And they were basically scenarios in which there was, in which, to my mind, there was unreasonable regulation of the fracking technology in the U.S. That if we look at EIA's low EUR case, which I think is something which probably is more representative of what could happen to the cost of producing natural gas if there were both onerous regulations on wastewater disposal by EPA and various kinds of state moratoria on fracking, both of which I think are realistic risks, we might not be exporting any natural gas at all. So there's nothing entirely certain about this market. But if we look at our reference case, so as long as the shale revolution is allowed to continue, the U.S. is going to be a low-cost supplier of natural gas to the world market. We see the U.S. in the reference case exporting about 1 trillion cubic feet of gas, that's 2 BCF a day, by 2023. The reference case was not that optimistic. The more optimistic case for the cost of producing gas in the U.S., we get up to about 12 BCF per day by 2023, 6 trillion cubic feet per year. Those levels of exports, how much we export and where it's going to go is going to be determined by the market. And the benefits of U.S. exports are pretty much going to redound to all exporters. I think that's a point that I would like to try to emphasize as I kind of look at where, how global trade would be likely to unfold with U.S. exports. There are circumstances under which there would be there could be an advantage for a particular country to have firm capacity for liquefying and exporting gas from the United States. But in many other circumstances, U.S. exports are going to raise all boats, that they are going to provide benefits of lower cost natural gas imports to all importing countries. And the more U.S. gas, the more the U.S. Exports, the greater those benefits are going to be. So I think that thinking about the question in those terms and the kind of efforts that Congressman Langford and Congressman Poe are making to ensure that restrictions are not put on exports, maybe a more maybe more beneficial than trying to work on individual transactions and see if there can be an advantage there. Not to say that the U.S. is not a more attractive and more reliable supplier than Russia, Pakistan, or Iran. We are. And the U.S. is probably the only place in the world that a buyer is going to be able to go into the market, sign up for a tariff for liquefying natural gas, you know, purchase a long-term contract for liquefaction at pretty much a cost-based price, and then go into the market and buy the gas freely. There's nowhere else in the world that you can do that. Everywhere else you're going to be dealing with national companies of one kind or another who are going to be trying as hard as they can to extract the rents. That is, you don't have to pay it. Right now, it does not seem a buyer has to pay oil-linked prices to get natural gas delivered from the United States. There isn't much of anywhere else in the world that you can avoid doing that. Except in Europe, because as Mike said, I think we are already disciplining Russia's pricing behavior because of the threat of U.S. import, of U.S. LNG exports moving to Europe. Now, in our reference case, in fact, we don't see any exports going to India. In fact, we don't see exports moving physically from the United States to India in any of our cases. Most of our exports in our reference case go to Korea or Japan. That's just where the highest prices in the world are today. And in our high case, the more gas we have to export, we're going to be splitting it between Korea, Japan, and Europe. And eventually, if Russia continues to try to extract high prices from Europe, we could displace up to we could be shipping 7 trillion cubic feet a year, 14 BCF a year to Europe. That would basically collapse Russia's exports to Europe. It would cost Russia tens of billions of dollars a year, a substantial percentage of its export revenues for natural gas. And we think in that case, what the result would be is we would actually move the entire world LNG market toward a competitive price. Right now, there seems to be $2 or $3 a million BTU of rent that right now is being captured mostly by the countries that are exporting gas at oil-linked prices. If you were one of those who signed a contract with Cheniere early on, paying the tariff that's in those contracts, buying gas at the wellhead, you would be keeping that $2 to $3. Because once you paid for transportation and got it home, it would be a couple of dollars less than it was costing you to buy oil and gas from anyone else. I don't know how much longer that opportunity is going to remain, because there are lots of people who see that rent is out there. And the bottleneck right now, and for a while, is going to, even if DOE opens their process up completely, the bottleneck is going to be building of terminals. But there are a lot of, and the choke point is clearly at the terminal, but the question is, who's going to get that rent at the terminal? And I think we're going to be increasingly finding that the builders of the terminal are willing to go further downstream in the process to sell the gas closer to the market and take those rents for themselves. So that's why I think it's important to look at what's happening to the whole market. Because what we see happening in the whole market is basically that if the U.S., if the fracking revolution continues in the U.S., we should see fairly rapid convergence to a case in which gas is being priced competitively around the world. There are probably three views on that. The analysts at Rice University see that happening pretty quickly over just a couple of years. Ken Medlock and his colleagues. I think our colleagues, our friends at Deloitte see it happening in a reasonable period of time. And we've just looked at scenarios for how quickly it could occur, for what the implications are of it occurring at different rates of speed. But the difference is there that whether the individual exporters are getting gas from the United States will get the benefit of being able to buy gas at U.S. prices, or whether all importers will be getting the benefit of the additional U.S. supplies in the market. And we see those supplies by themselves may be reducing prices of natural gas delivered to India by 15 to 50 cents a million BTUs. So that's just getting the U.S. into the market. And room being made for it by the other, basically, monopolistic suppliers like Qatar and Russia and Russia, basically. But if they discover that they have to meet the U.S. wellhead price plus transportation, it's a big drop in price for everybody in the world. Now, so where do we see gas actually going? Well, the difference here is India really is the closest place for the Middle East to send gas. Transportation costs are a lot cheaper from there than they are from the United States. For the U.S., the lowest transportation costs are to either Korea or Japan or to Europe. Though we also did the study for the recent filing by the Alaska Gas Pipeline Company for their opportunities to export, and I would say keep your eye on Alaska as a possibility. Though I think they are going to be looking for pretty much oil-linked prices to justify some of their investments. So not quite clear how good an opportunity that is. But I think there are many ways of hedging in the market, and that's probably what I will stop with here. One way of hedging is to get a contract for firm exports for firm liquefaction capacity from the United States, hedge your purchases at the U.S. wellhead and bring the gas back to your country. Well, of course, you don't really have to bring your gas back to your country. You have a hedge built in when you have that arrangement set up in the U.S. already. It's kind of like China buying up oil properties in Africa. I understand China isn't moving much of that oil back to China. They're selling in the open market, and they're buying oil where it's more advantageous to get it into China. So there are lots of commercial possibilities that can be worked on here, as can hedging by buying into U.S. Gas reserves themselves, participating in the market in the gas in the U.S. where gas can be produced and sold profitably. So I think there are many opportunities here. The U.S. is quite is open, and in all of them, the U.S. investigates and looks at foreign companies. But there's possibilities of investment in the U.S., investment in the terminals, as well as possibilities of kind of finding a more reliable supplier. The major uncertainty I would say here to worry about in the U.S., well, there's partly political uncertainty. I find what the administration is doing right now with gas exports totally opaque. I don't know whether they have not committed to anything, except I'm pretty sure that we're not going to get 12 BCF of actual final approvals of capacity for quite some time. Because it's going to take a long time before that many projects come out of the FERC process. So maybe we're okay over there. I think the big risk of being an investor in the United States, of tying yourself to the U.S. market, is what's going to happen politically about fracking, where I would watch the development of the environmental opposition to fracking to see whether that becomes a matter of concern. So thank you for your invitation and your attention.
We should invite to the podium Congressman Olson. He's from Texas, Congressional District 22.
Yeah.
He is also a member of the House Energy and Commerce Committee, and he has a very, very good working relationship with Indian Americans in Sugarland, Texas. So we wish to welcome you to the podium.
Namaste. Good afternoon. My name is Pete Olson. I'm from Houston, Texas, the energy capital of the world. It's also the Inter-American capital of America. I have a huge population of Inter-Americans in my district, the most diverse district in America. And right now, as we talk about through the experts about energy in America right now, we have revolutionized, guys. We're finding more oil and gas now than we never thought possible 10 years ago. It's game-changing. We're actually talking about exporting LNG from America, liquefied natural gas, to friendly countries. Maybe even some oil in the future. If we open those spigots, Mr. Putin cannot do what he's doing right now in Ukraine. He has a hold on Eastern Europe because he has their energy. He has their oil. He has their gas. We can't take that away from them. And how about India? The largest democracy in the entire world. A true democracy as we saw with the recent elections. And a great market for America. As a matter of fact, I went to India in December. Kind of an awkward time to go there because as we left Newark, we found out that we had some problems in New York City with the council general, the deputy council general that we arrested her and trips are not good to fly into. But I saw a healthy democracy in India. The press was great. Strong press, free press. They were honest, honest, honest. In our hotel room, trying to decide, make comments about what happened in New York City. I also saw a strong willingness to work with America. Realize that we've made all this progress, so much progress, in the last decade. I was in the Navy. I went to a small island in the Indian Ocean called Diego Garcia, about 1,000 miles due south of the point of India. We flew up there by India a couple times. In those days, 1994, India was neither friend nor foe. They got weapons from the Russians because we were aligned with the Pakistanis. but they weren't hostile to us, they just were kind of out there. In the last 10 years, that has all changed. They are our greatest ally in South Asia. No doubt about that. We have Council General 104 in Houston, Texas. Council General Harish. He came off last year about this time. Within 1 week, he had me down in his house for a long, long, long breakfast. He talked about LNG, how important it was for India to keep progressing. We all know what's happening, right, guys? We've had great changes. India is struggling to keep going with their growth because they don't have any oil, any gas. They buy that from countries that they don't like, that we don't like. Qatar, Iran, Russia. But they have to get their oil and gas. Right now it's not coming from America. And that's why it's so important we export LNG as quickly as possible. That's a win for America. Obviously, we have production in America, the pipelines, refineries, load on ships, those across the ocean, brings money back from India. It makes India stronger. More trade between two countries is a great thing. It's great for the world. And as y'all know, we started this process. Share. Right there is Sabine Pass, right on my state's board, Louisiana. It's right now building the first LNG export plant. And those have some contracts with India right now to have the gas going over between as quick as possible. We've got seven other LNG export plants online right now. Let's keep doing that. Again, I saw what a healthy relationship we have. Both common values, democracies, rule of law, you know, tied to the British Empire. And going to so many diversity of our people. And so that's why I can assure you, on energy and commerce, I will do everything I can to make sure we open that spigot and have American liquefied natural gas going to India. As I want to point to you about India, they have that our gas, guys. They can't get gas over land. Right? To the west is Pakistan. Good luck with some pipeline coming to Pakistan to India. That's not going to happen. To the north, wow. Some big mountains. They call the Himalayas. 15,000, 18,000, 25,000 feet. Build a pipeline over that. God bless you. You're doing Lord's work, miracle work. And to the south and in the east, not as different. Seems like the guys who caused the problems in the east just sort of do their operations down there. So the way to help India out is with ships. American ships, American natural gas coming to India as quickly as possible. The other group of very impressive persons, group of people who said, please, please, Congressman, get this going now. The Tata Band. Met with them. Again, this was what I'm so proud of and how strong our relationship is. Again, we had some problems with what we did in New York City. The government officials said, no, can't meet you. Good. That's helping. Right? Then a number of our people in here, we do the same thing. I thought that was a good sign. But we have the Tatas in Mumbai. And like most people we talked to said, heat is a bad thing, but we made so much progress in the last decade. We can't let this small thing derail that progress. And that's what I'm excited about, what we're doing in India right now. And then I want to invite you guys, as I mentioned, the largest Indo-American population in America is in Texas 22. Who's been to a holy festival? Festival of Color, the largest one in North America. Bigger is better in Texas, right? It's Roseburg, Texas, the first week of March. Come out, wear a white shirt, wear one you can lose because you'll be staying forever, and enjoy a celebration of color. And thank you, thank you, thank you for this opportunity to speak to all this afternoon. I've got to go above, but let's make India and America stronger, stronger, stronger. And that starts with exporting LNG. God bless y'all. Thanks. The food's kind of spicy. Oh, very good. Yeah, Texas, Alabama, those are not spicy foods. If you teach on a farm like Texas, you come down there. Just have to say y'all a lot. Y'all, y'all, y'all. Take care, man.
Thank you.
I'm still the member of the American Enterprise Institute, and I'm also the odd man out on this panel this afternoon, because I'm not an expert on LNG and don't pretend to be one. But I do spend a lot of time writing about and thinking about the US-India relationship. And so what I'd like to do briefly in my comments is kind of place some of the discussion that we've been having over here in the context of geopolitics and what's going on in Asia, and why it matters to the vital US relationship. I'm going to speak a little bit about the US-India partnership, the strides that it's made, where I see gaps that need to be filled, and how specifically free trade and LNG could be a game changer in that area. First of all, the most important thing to think about when you think about India right now is that we are experiencing an extremely significant moment, as Sanjay Puri had mentioned. You have had the most decisive election in India's history since 1984, with the election of Prime Minister Narendra Modi. But it's not just decisive in the sense of having produced a single-party government and effectively ended the era of coalition governments. It's also decisive because for the first time in Indian history since 1947, we've had a Prime Minister who has been elected on a platform of growth and development. So what you're seeing in India is a pivot towards, a pivot away from an old socialistic approach towards development, and one that's much more business friendly and much more reliant on releasing the entrepreneurial energies of the Indian people. As we speak, Secretary of State Kerry and Secretary of Commerce are in India, and we are on the eve of a strategic dialogue between the two countries. And in a few months, as most of you know, the Prime Minister himself will be visiting the United States. So that's just the context. Now, why is the US-India relationship so important? We talk a lot about shared values, and it's indeed true that both countries are democracies, the oldest and largest democracy in the world, as the cliche goes. But it's more than that. I would say that if you look at Asia from a perspective, from a Washington perspective, you look around Asia, and it's very hard to think of too many other countries that act as an implicit counterweight to China. Neither country explicitly sees China as a foe, but both countries are concerned by China's hegemonic ambitions. India is also a symbol of democratic capitalism, the leading symbol of democratic capitalism in Asia that matches the idea of authoritarian capitalism being fomented by the Chinese. India is a pluralistic society that is threatened by terrorism in the same way as the United States and its allies. And then lastly, it's an engine of economic growth, both in Asia and in the world. So all of these things have sort of held out the idea of a more robust US-India relationship as being central to US policy in Asia. And one way of measuring that is really to just look at presidential visits to India from the United States. Between 1977 and 2000, 23 years, there wasn't a single visit. Since the year 2000, just in the last 14 years, there have been three: President Clinton, President Bush, and then President Obama. So that gives you one sense of just how seriously, and there are not that many countries around the world where three successive US presidents have visited. But the one thing where I feel that the relationship really has grown dramatically, the US and India now have about 50 dialogues on various issues, discussing everything from energy education, to counterterrorism, to nuclear cooperation. But if you look at the relationship, the one place that it's lacking is really in having the same kind of economic heft as the US has with its other key Asian partners. Trade between the US and India is about $96 billion. That's about 1/8 of trade between the US and China. So if we want, in short, for the US-India relationship to fulfill its strategic potential, that strategic potential has to be anchored in a much deeper, more robust economic relationship. And if we're looking for gains that can be made quickly and beneficially on both sides, gas exports have to be central to this. So when I look at the energy picture from an Indian perspective, this is one of the world's largest, one of the world's fastest and largest markets. 75% of India's energy is imported, and estimates that I've seen say that that's likely to rise to 90%. What does the world and what does Asia look like, as some several of our speakers have touched upon, when India is forced to turn towards the unstable and chaotic lands of the Middle East, and frankly, the despotic regimes such as Iran that export the very dangerous form of fundamentalism, not just to South Asia, but to Asia more broadly and to other parts of the world. So I think there's an economic imperative for the US to free up exports to India. I cannot think of any single economic act that would cement this partnership more firmly. It would reduce friction between the two countries on climate change. It would reduce India's reliance on Middle Eastern energy and imports. It would weaken Russia's continuing hold over the region in many ways. And in short, it would bring the US and India, which are natural allies, the two great democracies, into an economic partnership that really matches what we have all spoken about, both in Washington and in New Delhi, as the great potential for a strategic relationship. So that I'd like to talk.
I'm Sue Gosch. I serve as USINPAC's legal counsel and legislative affairs counsel. And I wanted to respond to one issue that I don't think the panel has covered is why is USINPAC hosting an event such as this? What is our connection? Why are we interested? USINPAC is a grassroots membership organization. We have more than 1 million Indian American voters across the country. And we do have members in every single congressional district that may be naysayers at this point against LNG export anywhere or even to India. We have had a dialogue with the Energy and Commerce Committee members as well as other members, both House and Senate, educating them on the importance of LNG exports to India. One of the other facts that I don't think anyone mentioned is that in India, as well as in most of the developing world, the biggest health hazard is indoor pollution, and 90% of that indoor pollution comes from burning wood, coal, and dung in cooking stoves. So it is really, really important that we make a public interest case to export from the United States to India, and that's what we're trying to do. In closing, I wanted to say that this is just the first part of starting a dialogue, and the panel here is historic. There's never been a legislative briefing that I know of on exporting LNG to India. This is the first. We hope to continue this dialogue when Prime Minister Modi comes here in late September, and we are organizing already a series of events. You are welcome to visit our website and stay in touch with USINPAC to look forward to that dialogue. And we hope to make a difference in this. Thank you.
Thank you. Before we take questions from the audience, I had a question that I wanted to throw out to our panelists generally. We've all spent a lot of time today talking about the benefits of LNG exports to our strategic allies abroad, including India. And I would be curious to hear your opinions on what some of the negative impacts would be if the United States does not move forward expeditiously, or if the Department of Energy continues to stall.
Well, Well, if we don't, we're going to miss out on the benefits. So essentially, I've talked a bit before about how, you know, we had the shale revolution ongoing, and we've hit, you know, a point where we're producing about 72 or 73 BCF natural gas a day. That's going to increase because of increased natural gas use in the electricity sector. But we are demand constrained. And for us to continue with this momentum and to continue to create jobs and generate economic stimulus through oil and gas production, we need this additional market. So if we don't do that, we can lose a lot of the momentum we've had. And I'd like to point out that from 2007 to 2012, during the height of the recession, the one area where jobs were created at a high clip were in oil and natural gas extraction. By a 40% rate, jobs were created in that area. So we have a lot to miss out on if we don't move forward expeditiously and allow LNG exports to proceed, particularly to countries like India.
I'll just add to that briefly. I mean, if you look at the trade map of Asia and you look at if you look at US priorities, the big danger is sort of the larger danger is that as the TPP process moves forward, that you're going to have the US and India not in the same trading block. And so you're going to come to a situation where the strategic interests of the US are to deepen this relationship with India, but the economics of it is actually moving in another direction with TPP and so on, deepening relationships with another set of countries. And what you could do if you have freed up LNG exports is just ensure that the trade relationship, in fact, is locked in and becomes deeper and deeper.
Yeah, just a quick agree with everything that both of the others have said. And there's also the hypocrisy element here. I mean, politics has always got a certain element of that. But if you say things to the Prime Minister like, you know, we really value you as a strategic partner and we wonder, you have great perspectives on India, you're one of our closest friends, but then you say it incidentally when it comes to LNG exports, no, we're not doing that, we're going to keep the stuff inside the United States. It just smacks of you don't mean what you say.
I think there's another level of hypocrisy, which is if the U.S., which is we're borderline in violation of WTO rules, I would say right now, by not allowing exports freely. We can make excuses given the current status of the process, but we can't if the U.S. Actually puts some kind of a limit. The hypocrisy is that we've just succeeded in a WTO case against China dealing with their export of rare earth minerals. We accuse them of doing exactly the same thing that we're doing here, and we had a successful case at the WTO. I think the second thing, I reinforce the window of opportunity for U.S. exporters. As the world moves more toward competitive pricing, the big advantages for a U.S. export project financially and in terms of trade benefits to the United States are going to go away. And so I think there is a window of opportunity that will be closing over the next 5 to 10 years for the U.S. to get into this business of exporting in the most profitable way to the U.S. And then the third is, I think we will send one more signal to Russia if we do that, we are not going to do anything to counter their aggressive expansion in Europe.
Yeah, I'll just say it's just a lost opportunity, and it's what would be a sad state of affairs. Our one project at Sabine is the largest construction project in the country. So if you ever want to compete now on a global scale with the Indias and the Chinas of the world, you have to build, and I think it's would be a lost opportunity if we didn't have more projects online soon.
Great, thank you. We have a few questions from the audience. One of the questions is for Mr. Puri. The question is, what are the major markets for LNG export, and how do you see India?
I think this is a question more addressed to the panel. I can, I'd rather defer it to the panel, but one thing I would like to ask the panel if I can is, I was in India last week, and the question that came in from some of the administration folks, as well as a lot of the media folks, was, the Prime Minister might be looking for a Big Bang announcement during his visit. You know, the nuclear deal was a Big Bang announcement of what happened with the nuclear deal, but we won't go into that, etc. Can this be a Big Bang announcement, or is there even a possibility, given all the regulations and everything else, to give India that ability to do this? Because you heard from every member of Congress, every member of Congress gets asked by the ambassadors in India and politicians in India, export LNG to us. Every politician, every prime minister wants to take something back, and this might be also for Sadan and others. Can this be a Big Bang announcement? But to everything I've heard from you, that there are too many bureaucratic regulations and loopholes, that it's really not. So, but I'll defer to you guys.
I guess I just start on the fundamental fact, which is that natural gas will only flow from the United States to India if India makes a deal with the U.S. liquefaction terminal to sell them capacity and buys the gas in the United States market or from the U.S. exporter. There are lots of ways in which the U.S. government can prevent that from happening, but I can see no way that the U.S. government is going to make exports happen. It just does not control the LNG market, even informally, in a way that it could direct gas to go to India rather than to Korea or any of the other potential buyers. India's just going to have to get out there in the market and make the deal. I do think that the president has the authority to declare that exports to every country are in the public interest, and he probably has the authority to declare by executive order that exports to India are in the public interest. That's about the most that I can see.
I think that actually answers the question. I think that would be the expectation. And to answer Sanjay's question, yes, I do think that would be a big takeaway. If you can sort of say that until now you have needed specific authorization on every deal, but now we've decided that these exports are going to be opened up and India can participate in this market as fully as any FTA country, that would indeed be a big takeaway.
I would echo that also. You know, I think that the way the Natural Gas Act is written right now, it would take an act of Congress signed by the President to change the law. But if there was some kind of an executive order or some sort of a trade agreement that changed the status from a non-FTA country to an FTA country, that would go a long way to bolstering the position and also to enabling exports to India in a much faster fashion. There certainly are a number of export projects out there that still have excess capacity, so it would be an imperative to sign up for capacity in those projects or to develop an India-specific project if that was what India was looking for.
Could I just ask you a question? It's an interesting technicality, but maybe I think one that matters. Having a free trade agreement for natural gas, because there are some countries with which we have FTAs that you still need DOE approval because it doesn't include natural gas. Does it work the other way? You could simply declare, we're going to sign an FTA just for natural gas.
I don't know. I mean, I'm not an expert in trade law by any means, but I guess from a layman's term, I don't see why not. I don't know if anyone else on the panel has a thought about that.
Yeah, I mean, cuts both ways, right? So most of the demand is in non-FTA. We have the only MOU or contract signed with an FTA country, and it happens to be South Korea, which when we started negotiations was not a free trade country. So I think yes, but it doesn't matter.
Right.
In the Indian case, I mean, we're very far. I mean, a lot of people want to see a US-India FTA, but this is not something that's close by, and it's certainly not something that would be feasible within the time frame we're looking at, particularly to come back to Sanjay's point, which you want, you know, you want to take substantive win changes with it, so that wouldn't be the right to go.
Yeah, we all want to see a false sense of security in the possibility that there could be an FTA at some point, and that gives you that feeling that we're going to be in good shape, but it's the time element of it, and it gets back to this international competition where we need to move so that these facilities can get built and can compete on level footing with other facilities around the world so that those U.S. supplies are therefore available. This is the same conversation that we hear with the TTIP and the TPP, I'm sorry, too many acronyms, but the point being that these agreements could take 5 years, and in 5 years the LNG market could be pretty well established. So we got to make sure that we are pushing the lever of the administration to move forward with these as quickly as possible so that India has this opportunity in front of it as quickly as possible.
I don't want to be too disruptive, but I mean, could have the president announce that if the Senate will pass H.R. 6, he will sign it. I'd like that.
So, I'm not an expert at all on Indian politics, but I think the answer to your question, the original question about could this be a big bang item, comes down to what the Prime Minister is expecting and what he is stating publicly he wants out of the discussions with President Obama. If this item is an important item for him, then sure, it could be a big bang. But if this is sort of low on the list and he has several other priorities, then it'll depend on what happens with those priorities.
So is this an important one? This is a big one for India.
Great, thank you. We have a number of questions. Paul has done a great job of writing on the index cards. Thank you. It's very helpful, actually.
Can you read the writing?
Yes, they're actually very, very nice handwriting for everyone. The first question is, what about Australia as a competitor? They are about to be the biggest LNG exporter and already Japan's largest LNG exporter.
Yes, I think Australia has everything except the relations with labor unions and the stable construction costs to be able to be a really effective competitor.
That's my understanding also. The cost for Australia to export natural gas at the moment is one of the most prohibitive things for them. Okay. The next question was, what can the U.S. do in terms of lowering transportation costs against European and Asian rivals? How can we help ships expanding and things like the Jones Act that raise transportation costs? So the Jones Act is a federal statute that requires that a vessel that is used in coastwise transportation in the United States be U.S. flagged, U.S. manned to a certain percentage, and U.S. manufactured.
I don't think that applies to exporting LNG from the U.S. to another country.
It does for importing, I believe, but not for exporting. But on the Jones Act, the Jones Act is ridiculous.
I think what's happened is, in the course of having this debate about exports, crude, condensate, NGLs, and now LNG, some interests have tried to insert Jones Act as something that needs to be looked at. It's certainly something that needs to be looked at, but it really bears no relevance because these are not coastwise points, and therefore it shouldn't apply, except for in the case of we just heard. So I think we're in a good position there when it comes to being able to ship freely, allowing markets to find those vessels to move the LNG.
This question is specifically for Mr. Toomey, although anyone else on the panel who'd like to answer, please feel free. The U.S. has strong expectations for exports of nuclear power, which have not been realized. Should U.S. condition exports to India, should the U.S. condition exports of LNG to India on progress in nuclear exports?
That's a really good question. And, you know, in many ways, even though both of these, you know, when you talk to U.S. and your divisions, these are spoken of in, they occupy separate baskets. But in many ways, they're close to each other, because
There are many reasons for the US-India civil nuclear deal of 2008, but one of the most pressing ones, particularly from the Indian perspective, was again this idea of energy independence and making India less dependent on Middle Eastern energy sources. Now, as we know, the nuclear deal has not been a great experience from either the Indian or the US perspective, partly because India passed a liability law, which has been quite dramatically different from international standards on liability, and as a result, it's been very hard for it to attract private investment. But to answer the question simply, I don't think that you should link these two, because I think that what you should aim for as a matter of principle is take your gains wherever you can. And if you try to link two already pretty complex pieces of policy, what you're going to do is almost certainly ensure that you get even less progress rather than more progress. So while I fully back the idea that US-India nuclear cooperation needs to, in fact, deliver on its promise, I would still keep that as a separate track rather than linking it explicitly to LNG exports.
Great, thank you. There is a question about what it takes to start the licensing process. Thank you. I will offer some remarks, and then also allow anyone else in the panel would like to offer some remarks. This is a question we often get from many of our clients. How do we start this process? What do we do? You actually have to have a fair amount of environmental information ready before you start the FERC process when you submit your application to commence the pre-filing process at FERC. You have to submit two resource reports, and you have to have had consultations with the US Coast Guard already. In terms of the DOE process, you just have to have information about your site. You have to demonstrate site security and pay them $50 filing fee, and that's about it. If it's an FTA authorization for a non-FTA authorization, you obviously want to be proactive about making the argument that your export is in the public interest, so that the information in favor of the public interest determination is already in the record, and you raise the bar for anyone who seeks to overcome that presumption.
And be able to secure financing. It takes about $10 billion to finance a terminal.
Sorry, I'm reading them as I'm getting them here, too. This is another question for Mr. Dumi. What is the number one thing you would like to see develop for Prime Minister Modi's visit to the United States in the fall?
I don't really have a number one in terms of a policy outcome. I think there's several important policy outcomes, one of which is LNG, another one would be stronger defense manufacturing relationship between U.S. defense manufacturing. In India, I would like to see some progress made towards a bilateral investment treaty, which could be a precursor towards an FTA. So these are all kind of big policy goals out there. But I think the most important thing for me when I think of this upcoming relationship is that, you know, to use a cliche, you can really hit a reset button over here. Because over the last 18 months, 2 years, we've seen a generally positive relationship, but there have been several hiccups. And most of those hiccups are really, you know, go back to economic mismanagement by the previous government in India. And what Mr. Modi has as an opportunity is to really retell the India story in a dramatic way, and along with that, retell the story of the potential of US-India cooperation. And so what I'm looking for from this is to kind of catalyze and re-energize the relationship and get people who were enthusiastic about it a few years ago and then found some of their enthusiasm flagging charged up and energized again.
Great, thank you. We have a couple of questions that are all along the same lines. They're related to greenhouse gas emissions. One of the questions, which I think is a very important question, is how the greenhouse gas emission reductions that we've talked about that natural gas has over coal, how do those compare to emissions from renewable energy sources? And perhaps also it might be interesting to hear from some of the panelists about what the possibility of renewable energy as a reliable resource is in the future.
Well, let me start out by saying I think they are pretty much independent from one another. Just in terms of emission factors, switching from natural gas to coal cuts emissions by about 50%. Switching from natural gas to renewables, if they truly are zero CO2 emissions on a life cycle basis, takes you down the rest of the way. But that's not where the competition is. We are seeing natural gas pushing coal out of electric power generation. Renewables, not so much. In fact, the cheaper natural gas is, in many ways, the more the better intermittent sources like wind and solar are going to fare, because you need natural gas to back them up. The biggest obstacle to wind and solar is that it's intermittent. You frequently don't have it when you want it, and that means that you need to build natural gas capacity to back up your wind and solar in order to make it a reliable source. So the cheaper the natural gas is, actually, the cheaper the wind and solar become to install.
I think looking at the DOE's Energy Information Administration projections, which I think go out to 2040 right now, they show a pretty significant increase in the use of renewables, but they also show that 75% of our energy, that range is still going to come from fossil fuels in the year 2040. So it's not that renewable use is not going to increase, because it is. It's just that fundamentally, fossil fuels, coal, oil, natural gas, are still more cost effective than other forms of energy. In the U.S., we're going to see pretty flat demand, I think, for oil and natural gas combined. Natural gas will go up. David can correct me on any of this if I'm wrong, which I probably am. But globally, more importantly, is that global demand for energy, where the U.S. demand is going to go maybe 10% through 2040, global demand is going to go up 50%, and there will be an increase in demand for oil and natural gas, whereas it's going to be flat here. So it all comes down to the fundamental fact that we're going to need oil, natural gas, coal globally for years to come. We're going to need more of it when we have this tremendous blessing here in the United States, where we have so much of it that we can take that gas and put it into global markets.
And an interesting factoid that Bjorn Lomborg cited yesterday in Senate here, Senate Budget Committee hearing, we were both testifying at, the reduction in greenhouse gas emissions that has taken place in the United States due to fracking and increased production of natural gas and substitution for coal and power generation is larger than the amount of electricity that is than the amount of energy of emissions that have been saved by the entire world's solar capacity.
Thank you. Related question, also on greenhouse gas emissions. Starting at production and moving through transportation and then ultimately consumption, what are the potential risks involved? What are the emissions profiles? And how do these balance against the net benefits? Large question.
You say that again?
I think the question overall is, looking from a greenhouse gas emissions perspective, we're talking about the savings of greenhouse gas emissions as we switch to natural gas. What are the impacts, the negative impacts, I guess, or how do they balance against the benefits of this switch as you look at the emissions profiles of production, transportation, consumption?
Well, I take it the question gets at the leakage problem in the processing of natural gas and in the transportation and so on. Still, while there's been at least one claim by one environmental group that there may be that the natural gas is actually competitive with coal in terms of emissions, it's the only study I know of that's claimed it, and most analysts who have looked at this question and the normal assumptions about the leakage rates, including the Department of Energy, conclude that it's considerably less that the greenhouse gas implications of natural gas, even taking the entire cycle but comparing to the entire cycle of coal, that they are considerably less. So while there is an issue with trying to constrain and control the methane emissions associated with the entire life cycle of natural gas, there's similar kinds of things to have to deal with in coal, and I think you're still better off going the natural gas route from a greenhouse gas perspective.
Next question, what will be the domestic price effect of an increase in exports?
You actually have some nice material on that in the packets here, but I would say in our reference cases, even if we had the fully marked determined level exports, we're looking at something like 10 to 20 cent difference in the U.S. price of natural gas.
Okay, great.
Right. I mean, that's exactly right. I think I cited that figure, actually. That was for about a 2 TCF increase in supply. And to give you a perspective, a little over 2 TCF. So we're at about 25 TCF or somewhere in that range. So 2 TCF is sort of 8% increase in quantity, and you get a 10 to 20 cent increase in the price of gas, which is what, maybe 4.55 right now, somewhere in there. So you get a sense of magnitudes. You get a relatively small increase in price for a larger percentage increase in quantity. And at least going by the Deloitte folks, you see that supply curve looking pretty flat over a fairly considerable range, so that even if it goes from 6 billion cubic feet per day or 2 TCF per year up to 4 TCF per year, it's still maybe another 10 or 20 cents or somewhere in that range. It isn't like you get a sudden explosion in gas prices. It just seems to be such a resource base and such improvement in technology and such capability to utilize that technology that at least over the range, over the period of time that we're thinking about, the price increases are relatively modest.
Actually, Mike's comment gave me a chance to think about that question a little bit more. Mike actually began his remarks with the most important principle. We're talking about international trade here. Any time comparative advantage shifts so that it becomes advantageous for a country to export more of one good, the price of that good is going to go up. It always happens. When you're talking about free trade, we cannot look at the price of the good we're exporting. We have to look at what we get for the resources that we devote to producing that good. That's where the benefit comes in. And so what is going to happen is, yes, natural gas will cost a little bit more because that's what it takes to bring forth the additional production that we are exporting. But since we are exporting that additional quantity, other countries who are buying that need dollars to pay for it. When they bid for the dollars, they drive up the value of the dollar. What that means is that everything else we are importing becomes cheaper. So the consumer is better off because they're paying a little bit more for the natural gas that we are producing in the United States, but they are paying less for the goods that they are importing from India, from China, from Europe, from all the rest of the world. So on balance, the cost of living goes down. One component goes up, natural gas prices, that always happens, and the price of the other goods go down because we are responding to an improvement in comparative advantage in our favor.
Great, thank you. That's actually very helpful. I have to admit, I did not do well in my college economics class, so this. That was a very easily digestible explanation. Another question, for those of us who cannot afford billion-dollar process, how can we participate in this transaction potential? My response to the question would be, there are a number of project developers out there, as I mentioned, who still have excess capacity. There are a number of projects that are still being proposed. The project developer bears the majority of the cost. If you're an off-taker at the terminal, you do pay a rate to the project developer that will include some of the cost that the developer has incurred, but that's paid over time. If anyone has any questions about what projects those are, I'm sure anyone at the panelists up here would be happy to let you know. There are also a lot of small-scale liquefaction projects that are in the development phase right now Now, I would assume that the overall costs for those projects are much lower because they're much smaller volumes. There's also potential, although I don't know how viable this would be for exports to India, but there's potential in the United States to export LNG in ISO containers. That eliminates the need for a LNG export terminal. So you can export those from any port in the United States that will allow you to do it. That is an option that is evolving right now, and there are some regulatory nuances that still need to be worked out with the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission. But I think that there are some options out there.
And that's if you're interested in a pure play. But if you have a diversified portfolio of U.S. stocks in your 401k, you are going to be benefiting from this expansion of exports, because you are going to be benefiting from the opportunities for U.S. companies to, you know, make more profitable investments and bring in better returns for your shareholders.
Great. Thank you. Just have three more questions here. What are the maritime issues that may be barriers to LNG exports? And the question includes cost of LNG tankers, security of the tankers, cost of transportation, etc. In my opinion, those are probably the cost is the barrier to the maritime industry, maritime portion of LNG exports. As we noted, the JARS Act does not apply to exports. Natural gas, you do have to go through a U.S. Coast Guard process to ensure the viability of the waterway for the vessel that you intend to use. That is a very well-established process, and there are some issues that some projects face when they are on waterways that require dredging and there's not sufficient funds, but that is not an insurmountable barrier.
Can I ask a related question? Because this came up in another one, too. In terms of the cost of shipping LNG, would there be advances in the shipping technology or the size of tankers and so on that could significantly bring that down, or are we kind of pretty much where we are going to be for the foreseeable future?
I'm not sure about the tankers, but the Panama Canal expansion is certainly going to be a big help, because when we can take, right now I don't believe you can take the biggest world scale LNG tankers through the Panama Canal. The bigger you get, the more economies you have in shipping. So the Panama Canal, depending on how they set the charges, could make it a lot more economic to move gas from the U.S. Gulf Coast to Japan and Korea, which would be the most attractive markets. I don't know of anything else that's likely to bring those costs down. But looking at our breakdown, the transportation cost, I would say, is looking to me like something like half the kind of what seems to be the going tariff rate for liquefaction itself. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I think to India, probably $1.50, $2.
Sure, okay. So we'll just wrap up with one final question, which is actually a question that I was almost waiting for someone to ask, which is the impact of the stalling of the Keystone Pipeline on energy exports in the United States. And I will be happy to start off response with that. The Sierra Club, one of the leading environmental organizations in this country, definitely invigorated their member base through their opposition to the Keystone Pipeline, and they have carried that invigorated membership base over to the LNG exports context. Regardless of that, however, the arguments they have made opposing LNG exports have been denied by the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission and the Department of Energy repeatedly. Their arguments also don't change in substance, so the arguments we have every reason to believe, unless there's some change in policy, will continue to be denied in every single export proceeding.
You guys take this one.
Yeah, I would just echo that, because we've seen some discussion in the news media that one facility in particular, largely in part because of its proximity to D.C. and being in Maryland, it's the Cove Point project that was going to become the poster child for the activist environmental movement against LNG exports. They were determined this will be the next keystone. But we've seen over the past 6 months approvals of Cove Point. We've seen very little movement in opposition to that that's really garnering much media attention. Nothing nearly along the lines of Keystone. And ultimately, if the question is really getting at what's the response, hopefully Keystone will actually get approved. But in the meantime, you know, the markets find ways to get that product to the purchasers, to refiners. Canada's looking at other options, but there's a lot of additional traffic moving a lot of crude by rail and by other pipelines and by other means. So while that's one pipeline, it's largely symbolic in the activist movement against fossil fuel development, whether it's natural gas development, and while we've seen the movement move to the export side of things to shut down hydraulic fracturing natural gas, we think the market and American ingenuity and the commitment of investors like Cheniere have allowed the energy revolution to continue forward in spite of that. And I think there's been a lot of success in seeing these projects move forward with the success that they've had.
Okay, great, thank you. Now I believe Dr. Park.
Thank you, Sandra. I actually wanted to thank you for beautiful moderation and the wonderful panel of speakers and the great audience. It's a little bit intellectual, actually a lot of intellectual talk, but everybody sat very patiently with attention. Thank you for that. I also wanted to mention that our liquefied natural gas LNG initiative director, Mr. Rahul Srinivasan, he couldn't come. He had organized a lot of work and he has been leading the five interns, made it a great teamwork. So, and he has conveyed his greetings to all of you. And also one more announcement that we hold webinars every fortnight, every 15 days. One of the coming webinars will be on LNG, Liquefied Natural Gas Initiative. If you all want to suggest some speakers or want to participate in some way, you can contact us. You can contact Subhosh, or any of the interns as well, especially Prasad. Thank you very much. Back to you.
Great. Thank you. And
I also wanted to thank our team of volunteers, Mr. Sunil, Mr. Bhalla, Mr. Sikand, and many other people who sometimes don't come to the front screen, but they're always there. So thank you.
Great. Thank you.